So good morning students, today we will be discussing why we ignore quantization of electric charge while dealing with charges on macroscopic scale, that means large scale charges. The concept of quantization of charge works only when we deal with less number of charges. It doesn't work when the number of charges on a body is very large. Now before this, let me tell you, what is the number of charges up to which we treat the charges to be microscopic charges? It is up to few hundred charges. And if it comes to more than 1000, then the charges are treated to be macroscopic charges. Now, while dealing with large scale charges or macroscopic charges, why we ignore quantization of electric charge? To understand this, let us consider a beaker containing some water. Here, when you look at the water, water appears to be continuous, like a single piece. The size of one H2O molecule is equal to, approximately you can say, negligibly small, approximately equal to zero. Very small. And number of molecules is equal to n, that is tending to infinity, very large. Now you consider say a positively charged body which is carrying so much of charges. In a small region. Like here you see, in this water, water appears continuous. Why? The size of the molecule is very, very small, and at the same time, the number of molecules is very, very large, and they are very closely spaced. So that is why it appears to be continuous. The same concept works in the charges also. Here, the value of one charge, that means magnitude of one charge, is 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. That is equal to 16 by 10 to the power 20 coulomb, which is equal to 0.20 times 0, then 16. 0.00, like this, 20 times 0, then 16 coulomb, which is approximately equal to 0. Like the size of a molecule is 0. Approximately zero, the value of one single charge is approximately zero. Okay. And the number of charges is very large. Very large. Tending to infinity. Now, charge is equal to, charge on this body is equal to Q is equal to Ne. This concept doesn't work here. Now, as you see, as the size of the molecule of water is very, very small, and the number of molecules are very large, and they are placed very close to each other, so water appears continuous. Exactly the same way, the value of charge is negligibly small, and the number of charges is very, very large, and they are very closely spaced. So, the charge also is treated to be continuous. Charge appears to be continuous. And the tiny structure of a water molecule does not show up here, and the tiny value of charge also does not show up here. So hence you treat the electric charge to be continuous when you deal with large scale charges. As I told you before also, large scale, by the term large scale charges, we mean macroscopic charges. And what is the range of macroscopic charge? If the number of charges more than 1000, then the charges are treated to be macroscopic. And if it is up to few hundreds, then it is treated to be microscopic charge. Okay, hope this concept is clear. Now, I will go to another topic, that is point charge. What is a point charge? Suppose this is a charged body, and this is another similar charge body. Their size is negligibly small. compared to the distance separating them. Then the charge bodies are said to be point charge bodies or point charges. Point charge bodies, in short, we call as point charges also. So don't confuse with that. So now, what is a point charge? If the size of the charge body is very small as compared to the distance separating the two charges, then the body is said to be a point charge body or simply a point charge. Okay. Now, there is another thing. So to understand Coulomb's law, you require this point charge. Coulomb's law, which I'll discuss now, Coulomb's law will be applicable or will hold good only when the charges are point charges and the charges are static. These are the two conditions for Coulomb's law to hold. Number one, the charges are to be point charges and the charges are to be static. Now, what is Coulomb's law? Suppose this is some charge Q1 and this is some charge Q. We'll be discussing a Coulomb's law. Suppose these are two stationary point charges, one is charge Q1, another is charge Q2. They are separated by distance r. Now, suppose say both are similar charges, positive charges. Then there will be force of repulsion between them. One will repel the other. Force of 2 due to 1, I write as F21. Similarly, force of 1 due to 2, I write as F12. One will be repelling the other. Now, what is the force with which they repel each other? That force is found to be proportional to the product of magnitude of the two charges. Magnitude of charge Q1 is Q1 and magnitude of charge Q2 is Q2. Suppose say, for example, I say it is 5 millicoulomb plus 5 millicoulomb and this is minus 5 millicoulomb. Say one is positive and the other is negative. In that case, magnitude of, if it is 5 coulomb and it is minus 5 coulomb, then magnitude of both is 5 coulomb only. If it is, suppose say, minus 1 coulomb and it is plus 2 coulomb, suppose, then magnitude of this is 1 and this is 2. So magnitude means, magnitude doesn't show of the nature. So plus minus sign doesn't come, only the value. So the force of electrostatic force between these two charges is directly proportional to the product of magnitude of the two charges and inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. If you combine these two, you get F is proportional to Q1 Q2 by R square. Now, this implies F is equal to some constant K Q1 Q2 by R square. Now, if the charges are placed in Vacuum or yard, then K is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. Epsilon naught is absolute permittivity of vacuum or air. What does this absolute permittivity means? The extent to which, if this medium between the two charges, if it is vacuum or air, then the extent to which this medium is allowing the force of this to be exerted on this and force of this to be exerted on this. That is the meaning. And it is a value 8.854. 854 is not required to be written, just 8.85, you write into 10 to the power minus 12 coulomb square per newton meter square. minus 12 coulomb square per newton meter square. And this value of K is now 9 into 10 to the power 9 newton meter square per coulomb square. These two values you have to remember for solving numericals. These are to be by heart. Now, with this, we get the formula now. F is equal to 9 into 10 to the power 9. I can write now F is equal to 9 into 10 to the power 9 Q1 Q2 by R square. This is the value of the force. Now, if the charges Q1 and Q2 are placed in some medium other than Yarrow waveform, then that K value will be equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon Q1 Q2 by R square. Epsilon is the absolute permittivity of this medium in which the charges are placed. So now the formula will become 1 by 4 pi epsilon Q1 Q2 by R square. Now this medium, which medium you have placed in, each value of epsilon will be supplied to you if at all there is a question like that. Okay. Now let us go to the Coulomb's law in vector form. Coulomb's law in vector form. Now for this, I consider two charges. Suppose say Q1, both I am taking as positive charges. Suppose this is Q2. This charge will repel the charge in this direction. F force on 2 due to 1, I write as F21. And force on 1 due to 2 as F12. Now, since I am writing it in vector form, say F12, force on 1 due to 2 is equal to K Q1 Q2 by R square. This is the magnitude part. I am writing it in terms of vector F12, force on 1 due to 2. Now, so this part is the magnitude part, so I have to put an unit vector, I have to multiply it with an unit vector. Now, force on 1 due to 2, I am writing F12, so I will show the unit vector corresponding to this here as R12 cap. Don't show the unit vector here because somebody may take this distance to be this much or this vector to be this much, then it will not be a unit vector. So unit vector has to be always in between the two charges. So R12 cap you show here, this direction and this direction matching. So this is the magnitude, now I multiply by R12 cap. So this becomes the force in terms of vector form. Similarly, F21 is equal to K Q1 Q2 by R square. Then R21 cap I have to show. F21 is like this, so R21 cap will be like this. Okay. Now you see, here I have shown R21, here only R. So I can do one thing. I can write this length as R is equal to R12 is equal to R21. It's all the same, it's magnitude only. So I can write here R12 square, R21 square. That is the way to denote. Now if you see here, R12 cap and R21 cap, they are in opposite directions. As they are in opposite directions, we can say R21 cap is equal to minus R12 f because they are in opposite direction. So this implies what? F 2-1 vector is equal to minus f 1-2 vector. Because you see, their values are 1-1, but directions are opposite. And this r12 and r21, they are also same. So this magnitude part of both is same. And each magnitude is 1, each magnitude is 1, so the value is same, but the directions are opposite. Now, which charge will exert force on whom the first? It is the Newton's third law. The force, when this charge exerts force on this, exactly at the same time, this charge will also exert force on this. So there is no action, cause and effect relation. That means, as if it is applied, if suppose this is applied, say this is applying the force part, this will apply the force next to it, it's not like that. They will apply force on each other together. That means there is no cause and effect relationship. That means Newton's third law is valid here. So if we call this force as action, then this will be equal to reaction. So action is equal to minus reaction. So Coulomb's law obeys Newton's third law. Okay. Another important thing, the force on one charge into the other is acting along the line joining the two charges. Such forces are said to be central forces. If the force act along the line joining the two bodies, then the forces are said to be central forces, like gravitational force. Suppose if you consider the gravitational force between them due to the masses, this will attract this in this direction, this will also attract this in this direction. I am talking gravitational force. The gravitational force also acts along the line between the two charges or two bodies. So gravitational force is also a central force. So in short, what is central force? If the line joining the two objects, if the force acts along the line joining the two objects, then the forces are said to be central forces. Now, so Coulomb's force is a central force. Now let us go to the Coulomb's force in terms of position vectors. In terms of position vectors. Now suppose this is some charge Q1 and this is another charge Q2. This is the distance separating them. I will write it like previous one. R is equal to R12 is equal to R21, and this is the origin position vector of this is suppose R1, and position vector of this Q2 is suppose R2. Now force on these due to this, if both are positively charged, is suppose F21. And this is another F12. Okay. Now we have seen F12 is equal to KQ1 Q2 by R12 square R12 cap. In terms of positional vector, you see R, you would go this way. Now F12 for that, this will be the unit vector R12 cap. For F21, this will be the unit vector R21 cap. Okay. Now R2 plus R12 cap is in this direction. So this as a whole, I treat as a vector in this direction. I will call this length as, now I am going this way, R2 plus this length, that I treat as a vector R12 vector. R2 plus R12 vector is equal to If you use triangle law, it is equal to R1, because these are in cyclic order and this is anticyclic. So this way I can write R12 vector is equal to R1 minus R2. Okay. Now R12 cap is equal to what? We know vector A, suppose I show you here, A unit vector of vector A is equal to 1, A vector by modulus of vector A. Same thing I have to get, R12 cap is equal to R1 minus R2 vector by R1 minus R2 vector's modulus, because R12 cap is equal to R12 vector by R12 vector's modulus. R12 vector is R1 minus R2, and R12 vector's modulus is modulus of R1 minus R2 vector. Okay. So this way, now another thing you see, R12, that's that already you know. Now F, F12 vector is equal to K Q1 Q2 by R12. R12, instead of writing R12 square, I will write modulus of R12 is equal to R1 vector minus R2 vector modulus square, right, into R12 cap. R12 cap I can write R1 minus R2 vector by R1 minus R2 vector, vector's modulus. So F12 is equal to K Q1 Q2 by R1 minus R2 vector modulus cube, then R1 minus R2 vector. This is the one. Similarly, exactly the same approach you take, you can write F21 also is equal to K Q1 Q2 by, now R21 you require, you have to take this, you have to go this way. R1 vector plus R21 cap is like this, so this you treat as R21 vector. So R1 vector plus R21 vector is equal to R2. So R21 will be equal to R2 minus R1. So that way you substitute directly. R2 minus minus R1 by R2 minus vector's modulus Q. So this is the way of representing the Poulos force in terms of position vectors. Hope you have understood this. In case of any doubt, you can contact. Okay. Now the force on one. Force on charge Q0, I write as F0, is equal to force on Q0 due to 1, that is F0 1, plus force on Q0 due to Q2, that is F0 2, plus force on Q0 due to Q3, that is F0 3. Now, how to find out this force in terms of vector? So I have written, I have shown in the figure the force on Q0 due to Q1 and force on this Q0 due to Q2. So let us add them in terms of vector. So this is your F01 plus F02 vector. This is the result of these two vectors. Now, force on Q0 due to Q3. This is suppose I say this much. That is f not 3. Now I take the resultant of these two. So this is now the ultimate vector. This is f naught 3 plus f naught 1 plus f naught 2. This is the result in the figure. Now what is the conclusion? Force on a given charge due to a number of charges is the vector sum of the force on the given charge due to the individual charges. And another thing is, when you took the force on charge Q0 due to Q1, even though other charges were present, their effect was not taken into account. That means force on a given charge is not affected, force on a given charge due to a charge is not affected due to the presence of other charges. So ultimately, the main conclusion is, when the force on a given charge due to a number of charges is the vector sum of the forces on the given charge due to individual charges, and the force on a given charge due to a charge is not affected due to the presence of other charges. So this is the force on an expression for force on a given charge due to a number of charges, or principle of superposition. And now we will go to the same thing in terms of vector, position vector.